good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. Please take your psalm book to psalm number 20. Please take your psalm book to psalm number 20. Psalm number 20.
Today, and these things is in thy name we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Psalm number 55.
handed out on the inside. We've got our service time. Sunday mornings at 10:30 is our preaching service. Sunday nights at 6:30, and then Wednesday nights at 7 is our Bible study. This week we'll be in 2 Samuel chapter number 8. We've got the soul winning times listed there below, salvations, baptisms, offering totals. And then I just want to thank everybody who organized and brought dinners over for my family while my wife and I were out of town. It's very rare that my wife and I both leave town together, just the two of us at the same time. And I say just the two of us. We did have baby Boaz with us, but when you have eight kids and you just bring one child, you feel like you're alone, you know, in comparison. And so we had a great time. I preached at Verity Baptist Church in Sacramento, California. Got to see a lot of old family and friends, and spent some time with my wife over the last couple days. So really appreciate those who helped out with that. And then the upcoming homeschool field trip is there for the Arizona Military Museum on McDowell Road in Phoenix. And the field trip's free of charge, and it's open to all homeschooling families with at least one child of preschool age or older. But we do ask that you just RSVP with my wife by text message, email, or through the events page of Facebook group, just so that she knows how many people are coming and can arrange that. So RSVP for that if you're planning on going and you haven't already. On the back, we've got the events for this Saturday. We're going to be having the preaching class, as usual, this Saturday at 7 o'clock. But at 6 o'clock, we're going to have a cake reception in honor of Ramon and Sarah Ventura. That's going to be at 6 o'clock. And so this Saturday, everybody's invited to celebrate with Ramon and Sarah with cake and so forth. And then preaching class to follow. We've got the birthdays listed there that are upcoming in the next few days. Is Dale here this morning? Is he here?
No.
All right. We got a bunch of birthdays listed there that are coming up over the next few weeks. And then the Bible memory passage. Who's working on Psalm 62? All right. Who's totally caught up, meaning that you've got verses 1 through 4 done? 1 through 4. All right. Lots of people. Very good. Keep going on that. And we'll have a prize for those who finish the whole thing in the end. That is about it for announcements. Let's go ahead and introduce our first-time visitors. If you have somebody here for the first time, why don't you introduce your wife to us?
Hi, this is Svetlana McKenzie from Bellevue, Washington.
All right, great. Thank you so much for being here. Anybody else here for the very first time? Yes.
This is my neighbor, Caleb, my good friend of mine's son.
All right, good to have you, Caleb. Anybody else here for the first time? All right, very good. Be sure to get to know all of our first-time visitors after the service. And with that, let's go ahead and sing our next song. Brother Segura, come lead us.
Song number 374. Song number 374.
Mom and Johnny. Nah.
374. Song number 374.
Oh,
we'll pass our offering plates around. And as the plates go around, let's turn our Bibles to James chapter 3. James chapter number 3, as we always do, we'll read the entire chapter beginning verse number 1. Follow along silently with Brother Garrett as he reads. James chapter number 3, beginning in verse number 1.
James chapter 3, the Bible reads, "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same as a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire the course of nature and is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beasts and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed in mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Doth the fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion in every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace." Brother Sean Fairchild, would please pray for us.
Father God, just humbly thank you for everything you do for us, and thank you for salvation and your word, God. We ask that you please bless this service. Let Pastor Anderson be bold to preach your word. Let our ears be open to hear your word, and just change our hearts towards you, God. We love you, and we thank you for everything you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Man, James chapter 3, I pretty much want to preach about the subject that this entire chapter is about, which is about the tongue. Beginning of verse number 1, the Bible reads, "My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. For in many things we offend all." Watch this. "If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body." Now, just from looking at that verse, that should show us right away that this is something that a lot of people are going to struggle with. If he says, look, if you can get this area right in your life, you're complete. You're perfect. You've got everything together if you can tame the tongue. And the Bible says in verse 3, "Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body. Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold how great a matter a little fire kindleth, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. The Bible's making it really clear here that this is going to be something that people struggle with. The tongue can no man tame. If you can bridle your tongue, you can bridle your whole body. This is something that can cause a lot of harm. A little tiny part of our body, the tongue, but it said that it can kindle great fires and cause great destruction. It says in verse 9, therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Do the fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. Flip back a couple pages to James chapter 1, and we'll see another mention of the tongue. And notice that the tongue and the misuse of the tongue is tied in with bitter envying and strife in your heart. What causes you to say things that are hurtful or that destroy people or that cause trouble and kindle these great fires? It's when you have bitter envying and strife in your heart. That's what causes these things to come out your mouth, because the Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And the bitter envying is when you think that you're better than other people and you wish that you have what they have and you're envious of them, and strife, just getting into conflict with people all the time instead of trying to be at peace with your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ in the local church, or being at peace in your family, being at peace on the job, etc., etc. Look at James chapter 1, verse 26. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. That's a pretty strong statement, again, telling us how important it is that we bridle our tongue. We don't want our religion to be in vain, so therefore we want to make sure that we bridle our tongue. Go to 1 Peter chapter 3. This is all by way of introduction. 1 Peter chapter 3, because what I want to really preach about tonight is specifically what are the sins of the tongue. We can talk about generalities of just, hey, control your mouth, control your tongue, you know, don't let it get out of control. But what specifically does God tell us in the Bible are the sins that we commit with our tongue and with our mouth? But first, look at 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8. It says, finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another. Love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous. Because, of course, if our heart is right, then the things that come out of our mouth are going to be right as well. It says, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips that they speak no guile. If you want to have an enjoyable life, if you want God to bless you and prosper you, and if you want to see good days, then you need to learn to control your mouth. You can't go around speaking guile and having your tongue participate in all this evil and expect to live a good life. It's not going to happen. That's what the Bible's telling us. Now let's go to Proverbs, because the book of Proverbs is a book that deals with the tongue literally in almost every single chapter. And as you go through the book of Proverbs, you'll just see scores and scores of verses telling you how to handle your tongue and telling you what not to do with your tongue. We could go all over the Bible. This is such a big subject that God deals with so much that we could go through hundreds of scriptures, literally. And this morning, we're not even going to hardly scratch the surface, but I'm just going to spend the sermon in Proverbs pretty much, because everything I need to preach this sermon is pretty much in the book of Proverbs. And the goal of this sermon is to get specific, not to just vaguely say, hey, you got to control your tongue, you got to watch your mouth, but rather, what does the Bible say, not a person's opinion, but what does the Bible say the sins of the tongue really are? And the first one that would really obviously come to mind and just jump right out at you would be lying. Go to Proverbs chapter 6. That's one of the biggest sins that you can commit with your mouth, is telling a lie. Proverbs chapter number 6. We're just going to be all over the book of Proverbs this morning. But while you're turning to Proverbs 6, I'll read for you from Colossians 3. Lie not one to another, seeing that you've put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Look at Proverbs 6, verse 12. The Bible says, a naughty person, a wicked man, walketh with a froward mouth. Jump down to verse 16. These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination unto him, a proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. So right at the beginning of this list of things that God hates and things that are an abomination to him, he says that a lying tongue is an abomination. Go to Proverbs chapter number 12, verse 17. God hates a lying tongue. Proverbs 12, verse 17 says this, he that speaketh truth showeth forth righteousness, but a false witness deceit. There is he that speaketh like the piercings of a sword, but the tongue of the wise is health. Verse 19, the lip of truth shall be established forever, but a lying tongue is but for a moment. Look at verse 22. Lying lips are abomination to the Lord, but they that deal truly are his delight. Look at chapter 13, verse 5. It says, a righteous man hateth lying. So not only does God hate lying, but the Bible says that if we're righteous, we will hate lying as well. It says, a righteous man hateth lying, but a wicked man is loathsome and cometh to shame. You don't have to turn there, but Proverbs 20, verse 17 says, bread of deceit is sweet to a man, but afterward his mouth shall be filled with gravel. Just imagine a mouthful of rocks and dirt. God says that's the punishment upon those who would tell lies. And so over and over again, we could go all over the Bible with lying, obviously. It's not just limited to a couple scriptures in the book of Proverbs. But God hates it. And I think sometimes we give lying a pass a little bit because we've all done it. So because every single person has done it, I mean, the Bible says, yea, let God be true, but every man a liar. And we often, when we're out soul winning and we want to show people that we all deserve hell, we show them that verse where it says all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And then we'll show them a little later where it says, whoso maketh a lie, you know, will not be in heaven. So because we've all done it, it's easy to want to kind of whitewash this sin. It's easy to be harsh on sins that we've never done. When we've never done it, we'll get up and rail on it, and we know how bad it is, and that's why we wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole. But with lying, we don't come down as hard on it sometimes simply because we know that we've all been guilty of it. And probably in the future at some point we'll be guilty of it again. But you know what? Just because this is universal of a sin unto us, that does not mean that we should take a light attitude. When God's saying it's an abomination, when God's saying that he hates it, when God even puts it in that list of things that will wind a person in the lake of fire, we ought to take it very seriously and understand that the Lord loves it when we tell the truth. And he hates it when we lie to him or lie to other people. You know, Ananias and Sapphira lied to the Holy Ghost. We need to be people who learn to tell the truth. And sometimes it hurts to tell the truth. But one of the biggest sins we can commit with our mouth, the biggest way to not have a bridle on your mouth is when you just let lies flow out of your mouth. And one of the worst things about lying is that it becomes a habit with people. There are people who lie just as a way of life. And they even get to the point where they start lying when there's no reason to lie. Your average person, when they really get in a bind and they, you know, they've got egg on their face, will maybe tell a lie to get out of it. Your average person will do that. But there are some people who just keep lying so much that they get to where they lie about things that don't even matter. They lie when there's nothing at stake and they become pathological. You'll hear that term thrown about. Or they'll tell so many lies that it just becomes a normal habit to them, and they even think that they're telling the truth. I mean, God forbid that any of his people would just have an abomination coming out of their mouth constantly. And children, you'll always be better off with your parents telling the truth. You get in more trouble when you lie about it. And then we, as God's people that are adults, we're his children. He's going to come down on us harder when we lie about it. He'll show mercy unto us when we confess and forsake our sins. And what's confession but simply telling the truth? Confessing that you've done, you know, that which is wrong. So obviously lying is a big one. But look at Proverbs chapter 4. Another sin that comes to mind with the tongue would be perversion or what the New Testament calls filthy communication. In Colossians 3:8, it says, "But now ye also put off all these anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth." Look at Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. It says, "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Put away from thee a froward mouth, and perverse lips put far from thee." Now look over at Proverbs 15, verse 4. He said, "Perverse lips put far from thee." I think of the famous scripture on alcohol in Proverbs 23, where he says, if you tarry long at the wine, and if you go to seek mixed wine, he says, your mouth will utter perverse things. It says in Proverbs 15, 4, "A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness therein is a breach in the spirit." So what do we mean by perverse lips or filthy communication or your mouth uttering perverted or perverse things? You know, the Bible talks about the fact that there are wicked, reprobate people in this world, and the Bible says that it is a shame to even speak of those things which are done of them in secret. And the Bible also says that fools make a mock at sin. And so if the Bible tells that fools make a mock at sin and that it's shameful to speak of that which wicked people do in secret, that tells me that it shouldn't be something that we take lightly and turn into a joke. And this is where we're talking about filth and joking about filth. And the reason I bring up joking is because it seems to me that most of the time when the filthiest things come out of people's mouths, it's usually in the form of a joke. They're just kidding. Kind of gives them an excuse to talk about something that normally would be too disgusting or filthy to bring up. But hey, if you're doing it as a joke, it's okay. And by the way, the sodomites that are all over TV, that's how it started. Because if you look back to the real old movies, the hero of the film is not a sodomite. Right. But you know what they'll do? They'll have sodomite characters that offer a comedy, or a comic relief of some sodomite. Or you can even go back to the oldest black and white movies of Hollywood and you'll see people dressed in drag, men wearing makeup. But oh, come on, it's just a joke. It's just funny. Or you go back to even the Bugs Bunny cartoons, and one of the common themes of Merry Melodies is that Bugs Bunny would be dressed in drag, put on lipstick, and he's kissing Elmer Fudd on the cheek and all that. Elmer Fudd's turning purple and green and everything like that. And they're programming the young people to say, hey, it's funny. It's cute. It's funny. And this has been the progression with Hollywood, with the sodomites, is that, first of all, it's a joke. It's funny. It's silly. We laugh at it. And the devil spent decades getting us to laugh at that sin. Even from when we were the tiniest kids with our bowl of cereal on Saturday morning in front of the cartoons, we're being taught that being a transvestite's funny. Being a homo's funny. I mean, it just starts the programming that young, and we laughed at it, right? Then the next thing was, oh, stop laughing at that. That was the devil. Phase one was like, laugh at the homos. Then the second one is, how dare you laugh at them? And then it became the, oh, poor homo. Everyone's laughing at the filthy sodomite, you know, and that was the next stage of the plan. And then, of course, now we're on to a whole new stage of, well, this is completely normal. They're born that way. They're wonderful. Let's make them the pastor of the church. Let's go ahead and let them get married. And let's, you know, we're just off the charts now with the accept. We're even Christians now accepted and accepted in the church and accepted in the house of God and everything else. And if somebody says, hey, no homos are allowed in this church, it's in the news or something. Just because it's just, oh, whoa. When in reality, they never would have been allowed in any church, you know, going back a few decades. So we see that it started with a joke. And you know what it reminds me of, too, is even when Lot was in Sodom and he tries to preach the word of God unto the people of Sodom, some of the people that were there, his sons-in-law, that were residents of Sodom, that had married his daughters, he, you know, it was all a joke to them. They thought it was funny. They're real funny people. You know, they joke around a lot. And let me tell you something. There's nothing wrong with having a good time, and the Bible talks a lot positively about making merry and being joyful and having a good time. But you know what? There's nothing funny about sodomy. It's just not funny. Amen. And if you find yourself joking about it, or other people joking about it, it's only because you've been programmed that way since you were a little kid watching Bugs Bunny. That's where it's coming from. It's not coming from the Holy Spirit, and it's not even coming from who you really are as a person, the new man. I'll tell you what's coming from. Just a brainwashing where you've been taught that it's funny, and it's really not funny. It's gross. It's disgusting. It's filthy and wicked. It's reprobate. It's vile. It's reprehensible, but yet people joke about it, don't they? I mean, you hear a lot of jokes about it out in the world, and it's not funny. And you know what? If you're joking about homos, that's filthy communication coming out of your mouth. And when you're telling stories about homos, and it doesn't, and look, homos are not the only perverse thing out there. There are other perversities as well. None of it should come out of your mouth. You know, you shouldn't even be joking about committing adultery or something. You know, some fools make a mock at sin. You don't make jokes about committing adultery, joking about that. You know, you need to keep your mouth from perversity and filth from coming out of it. And this is a big one in 2015 because, you know, the homos are something that are on everybody's mind because it's being brainwashed and crammed down our throat every day because of the media. But not only perversion coming out of our mouths, not only lying, what are some other sins that we can commit with our mouth? Go to Proverbs chapter 8. Another sin that often is committed by the tongue is the sin of boasting, bragging. And you've been around people that do a lot of bragging, a lot of boasting. And this is not the humility that God calls us to as Christians. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 8, verse 13, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride and arrogancy and the evil way and the froward mouth do I hate. God said, I hate that froward mouth. In the same breath that he says, I hate pride and arrogancy. Flip over, if you would, to chapter 25. Chapter 25. Of course, there are a lot of scriptures on bragging and boasting in the Bible. One of the most famous ones is about our salvation when it says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And so God says our salvation is not of works. If it were, someone could boast about it.
Right.
And have you ever been out soul winning and talked to the unsaved who don't realize it's by grace through faith? And they'll boast to you.
Yeah.
You ask them, how do you know you're going to heaven? Oh, man, I'm a good person. Oh, I really help a lot of people. Or this is the funniest one. Hey, how do you know you're going to heaven? Well, I've rescued 12 animals. It's like case closed, next door. Well, you know, we're wasting our time here. We need to go to the next person who needs it, you know. But they'll say, well, I've rescued 12 cats. You know, I've been good to animals my whole life. It's like, well, you're in like Flint. But they say, you know, they'll tell you all kinds of boasting. And it's almost, you're almost embarrassed for them sometimes. And honestly, whenever people brag and boast, it's embarrassing to the people around them. You're kind of thinking like, are you serious? When they say, you know what, I'm just a really good person. I just have been, I'm just a really good guy. I really help people. Or you're like, what in the world? Do you really believe that about yourself? But people do. And you'll hear other people just brag to you and just tell you about how much money they have, tell you about all their achievements, tell you how wonderful. And what does the Bible say? Let another man praise thee, not thine own mouth. Strangers and not thine own lips. So we don't want to be prideful, arrogant people who go around tooting our own horn, singing our own praises, talking about how wonderful we are. The Bible says that we should not think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Now, look at Proverbs 25, verse 14. It says, whoso boasteth himself of a false gift is like clouds and wind without rain. Because a lot of the times when people are boasting a lot, they don't really have the goods. A lot of times they boast a lot because they're insecure and they're trying to lift themselves up because they don't really have the skills that they're claiming to have, or they don't really have the money that they want you to think they have. You know, some of the people with the biggest, baddest toys and all the fancy stuff are in debt up to their eyeballs, and really, you know, they're going to lose it all eventually anyway once the bill all comes due, because they're robbing Peter to pay Paul as they build up this huge debt to have all the toys, and they can boast about the four-wheel drive and the boat and the RV and talk about the jewelry and all the wonderful things that they've been able to afford and just tell you how great they are and what a great Christian they are and what a great, you know, businessman they are and what a great athlete they are and how everybody just loves them. And so, you know, we need to be careful that we don't get prideful in our heart and let it start coming out of our mouth in the form of boasting or bragging. What is he talking about when God says, get your tongue under control? The tongue is a fire. It's a whole world of iniquity. It's not just one sin that your tongue commits. It's a whole world of iniquity. What does that world of iniquity encompass? Obviously lying. Obviously perversity and filthy communication coming out of your mouth. What's a third sin that we commit with our mouth? Boasting, bragging, pride, arrogancy. But not only that, look at Proverbs chapter 18, verse 1. This is one that might not come to mind as readily, but this is another sin that people do commit with their mouth. And the funny thing is, even though this point, if I were to go around the room and ask people, name all the sins you commit with your mouth, you know, we'd get a lot of answers coming at me. Let's just go ahead and do that. Let's do some sin. We've already covered three. What other sins can you commit with your mouth? Slander, railing. Yeah, that's. I've got that point later in the sermon. It's coming. You know, the backbiting, the tail-bearing, the... Okay. Well, now you're ruining my sermon because he just nailed the point. I was gonna see if no one would guess it. Saying stupid things. And what's funny, he said foolishness. Lewis said, you know, it's funny because that doesn't always come to mind. You know, lying, of course. You wouldn't think of just saying stupid things as being a sin. But in fact, when I looked up this subject, because I just wanted to look at everything the Bible said about the mouth, the tongue, the lips, speech, it was too much. I mean, there's just hundreds and hundreds of scriptures. So I was like, okay, let's just look at Proverbs. And even when I narrowed it down to Proverbs, that was the one that God talked about the most. Of all this in Proverbs, was just saying stupid things or foolish things coming out of your mouth. Now, let me kind of explain this point a little bit. Look at chapter 18, verse 1. It says, through desire, a man having separated himself, seeketh and intermeddleth with all wisdom. A fool hath no delight in understanding, but that his heart may discover itself. Now, the word discover meant something a little bit different in 1611 as what it means now. Today, when we think of discovering something, we think of, you know, you went out and found something that no one else knew about. And you went out and uncovered something that was unknown to the rest of the world. You know, you talk about somebody who discovered, you know, the New World, Columbus. You know, obviously there were people here before that from all different places. But, you know, oh, you know, he discovered this, he discovered that. But here's what discover actually means in the Bible. When you see the word discover, it actually means to reveal or to uncover. When the Bible says here, a fool hath no delight in understanding, but that his heart may discover itself. He just wants to tell you what's in his heart. Basically, translation, he likes to hear himself talk. No delight in understanding. Not interested in hearing from someone who actually knows the subject. But rather, he just wants to hear himself talk. He just wants to make sure that you know what's on his mind. Right. He just wants his heart to discover itself. He wants to make sure that everything that's in his heart comes out of his mouth because he likes to hear himself talk. Now, there are a lot of verses in the Bible that talk about people not talking about things that they don't understand. Now, go to Proverbs chapter 15. Proverbs chapter 15. And like I said, I can't read all the scriptures on this one just because there were so many that talked about this. But Proverbs chapter 15 says this in verse 2, the tongue of the wise useth knowledge aright, but the mouth of fools poureth out foolishness. Verse 14, the heart of him that hath understanding seeketh knowledge, but the mouth of fools feedeth on foolishness. Verse 28, this is all just in one chapter. The heart of the righteous studieth to answer, but the mouth of the wicked poureth out evil things. Look at chapter 10 of Proverbs. Chapter 10. While you're turning there, I'll read for you from Proverbs 16, verse 21. The wise in heart shall be called prudent, and the sweetness of the lips increaseth learning. Understanding is a well of life unto him that hath it, but the instruction of fools is folly. The heart of the wise teacheth his mouth, and addeth learning to his lips. Look at how many verses are saying that we need to learn, study, understand, and gain knowledge so that we can speak intelligently. So that wisdom and understanding and the truth and intelligence can come out of our mouth, not just stupidity and foolishness and talking about things that we don't understand. Jude verse 10 says, but these speak evil of those things which they know not. but what they know naturally as brute beasts and those things, they corrupt themselves. Look down. Where did I have you turn? Chapter 10, I think? Yeah. Look at verse 31. The mouth of the just bringeth forth wisdom, but the froward tongue shall be cut out. And so over and over again, we see this in the book of Proverbs. Chapter 12, verse 23 is another good one. Look over there. It's just a page over. Proverbs 12, 23. A prudent man concealeth knowledge, but the heart of fools proclaimeth foolishness. Now, this is such a profound verse when you realize it. It's saying, look, the guy who's smart, he's hiding more intelligent things than the stupid things that you're just letting pour out of your mouth. I mean, the Bible's saying that even an intelligent person with important knowledge sometimes doesn't always feel the need to just say everything that he knows or say everything that's on his mind. But yet the fool just, not only does he say everything he knows, he just says stuff he doesn't know. He just talks. He just blows off his mouth. He just pours out a stream of foolishness. And there are a lot of people today that talk about subjects that they're unqualified to talk about. Now, I do not believe that we need to be experts in every subject. There are a lot of things that I don't know anything about, that I don't really care about, that I'm probably never going to know about. And so I don't just go into long dissertations about them and just start talking about a bunch of stuff that I don't understand. What we need to learn is that it's better to hear, you know, and it's better to listen and hear and learn things than to just talk for the sake of talking. Now, if you have something that's profitable, if you have something that's intelligent, that's edifying, that's helpful, that's important, that's interesting, that is true and you've checked out, then speak the truth. You know, teach people. Be a person who helps others understand knowledge. But there are certain times when someone asks you your opinion about something, when you should just say, well, you know what, I just don't know about that subject. Than to just feel like you have to weigh in on everything and just give your opinion about everything. And even when you're not asked, to just, you hear people talking about something and just, well, here's what I think about that. You've not read a single book about it. You've not studied the information. You've not. And look, we could go through so many subjects today that people just talk about without knowing anything about it. And then when you start pinning people down about what they know about these subjects, they don't know anything about it, but they just blow off their mouth of foolishness. You know, something that just popped into my mind was, you know, I said something negative about Mother Teresa one time as a teenager, and everybody started yelling at me and telling me how bad I was at my church. And I said to them, I said, do you know anything about Mother Teresa? I said, what country does she live in? They don't know. I said, what language does she speak? Can you give me a quote from her? Do you know, can you tell me anything about her life? Can you tell me the years in which she operated? You know, can you tell me what religion she is? And these people literally knew nothing, but they were yelling at me, telling me I was a wicked person for saying something bad about Mother Teresa. You know what they should have said was just, well, I don't know anything about Mother Teresa. You know, I need to, you know, before I can weigh in on Mother Teresa, I need to go do some study. But they said, Mother Teresa's in heaven, and Mother Teresa, how do you know? What do you know about her? How do you know her testimony of salvation? She's Roman Catholic. She's trusting works. And if you read the quotes out of her mouth, it's anti-Bible. It's anti-everything that is true and everything that is the true religion of our Lord Jesus Christ. But you've just been told your whole life she's a wonderful person. Or, you know, you say something negative about Martin Luther King Jr. and people are going to jump down your throat, call you racist and everything because they just don't even know the facts. They don't even know the subject. Or politics. You know, it's funny. People just, they've been told their whole lives in church, just vote. Just get out there and vote. Just vote. Exercise your right to vote. And people literally just go to the poll and vote and they don't know anything about the issues. They don't know anything about the candidates. And honestly, when you go down there, most of the names on that are foreign to you and you don't even know who they are. All these judges, do you want to confirm or reject this and that judge? It's just a bunch of names. You know, I used to go in there and just all the women judges, I'd just say no to all of them, you know. Just because I don't believe that women should be an authority in our government, you know. So I just leave the men blank because I don't know who they are. And then the women's just like, nope, nope, you know. Catherine, Susie, you know, whatever. But I'm just saying, you know, it's ridiculous to just constantly be talking about things you don't know or you don't understand. And it's funny, like okay, this is maybe a petty, silly example, but you know, I really like to run. You know, I run every day. And it's so funny how people will take me aside and give me running advice who don't run at all. They literally do not run at all, whatsoever. Now, I only started running a few years ago, you know, and until I was 29 years old, I hated running, and I would never go running unless I really had to, and I hated every minute of it. You know, but in the last several years, I've really learned to enjoy running. I love running. I run every day, and it's something I really like. And people will tell me, you know, you're not doing it right, you know? And I'll ask them, like, do you ever, no. Well, I run on a treadmill sometimes. And they, you know, it's just funny how people will just talk about subjects that they don't know anything about. Now, look, I could name for you a lot of subjects that I don't know anything about. You know what? I don't know anything about football. I'm just going to admit it to you right now. I don't know about it. And there, you know, there are certain areas of science that I don't know anything about, that I don't talk about. I don't really know. You know, and people are constantly coming to me and asking my opinion about certain things. And you, anybody who knows me knows that I don't just give my opinion about everything. Sometimes when people ask me something, I'm just, I don't know. I don't know anything about it. I don't get into it. You know, people come to me and tell me, you know, what do you believe about this, you know, the geocentricity or you know, whether the sun goes around the earth or whether the earth goes around the sun. And they're trying to lay out all the evidence for me. And I just tell people, you know what, I don't care about that subject. I don't know anything about it. I'm not qualified to talk about all the science involved with that because I have not studied it. So I don't want to just start coming down with real strong opinions. And here's the thing. I've seen the biblical evidence for geocentricity. And honestly, I don't think that the biblical evidence is conclusive at all. I'm not buying it. But when it comes to whether the sun goes around the earth or whether the earth goes around the sun, honestly, I don't know. Because I don't think that the Bible has a firm answer on it. And I'm not gonna, you know, spend the time and the energy to go out and research that. I'm not against somebody who likes science, who wants to do that. But honestly, I don't know, I don't care. So I'm not gonna just give these real strong opinions about, you know, this is how it is, because I don't know. And I don't think it's a biblical issue, and so I don't care. Now, I'm a pastor. Therefore, I strive to be an expert in the Bible. But that doesn't mean I'm going to be an expert in all matters of history. You know, there are certain parts of history that I know a lot about, that I've really studied a lot, and that I can speak intelligently about. But there are a lot of other areas of history where people start telling me about it, and I say, wow, I don't know anything about that. I'm going to have to look into that. You know, or what do you think about this guy? What do you think about that? I don't know. You know, I'm going to have to look into that and study that. I'm not sure. I don't know. There are things that we know a lot about and things we don't know a lot about. Now, when it comes to areas of evolution and the Big Bang, I've actually studied that a lot just because, you know, I wanted to be able to talk about it intelligently and preach about it. And so I've read up on those types. But there are a lot of areas of science that I don't know anything about because I'm just not that interested because there's so much knowledge in the world and everybody specializes in different things. You know, we all want to have a basic knowledge of everything. But then there are certain areas that would take a whole lot of study to delve into and really get into. And I think that we in America today have been taught that we just have to have an opinion about everything. What do you think about this guy? What do you think about what he said? What do you think about him? What do you think about her? What do you think about this subject? What do you think about this issue? What's your opinion on this? And I think that we need to learn to sometimes just say, I don't know. I don't know anything about that. Rather than to just start pouring out foolishness. Because a lot of times what people do will just start repeating stuff that we've heard. And you know what? I've been guilty of it. We've all been guilty of it. Not saying I've never done this. Where you'll just start repeating stuff that you've heard, and then later you go back and study it and you realize, wow, was I wrong about that? And I can tell you something. I've been pastoring now for over 9 years, and I can honestly say that if I go back and listen to my old sermons, sometimes there are things that I said where I'm like, wow, I don't agree with that anymore. I don't believe that anymore. But thankfully, it's not biblical issues because there are very few things biblically because I've just made a practice that when I don't know things biblically, I'll gloss them over. Like on a Wednesday night, I'll be preaching verse by verse, and sometimes I'll just kind of gloss over a few verses because I don't understand what it's saying. Okay, so I'll just kind of gloss them over. And then people will be like, man, I was hoping you were going to cover that verse. That was the one I was wondering about. And I'm thinking like, yeah, I was wondering about it too. You know, that's why I didn't cover it. But don't, you know what? And I remember I had a pastor call me one time. He's like, you got to help me. Because he's like, it's Wednesday night and I'm preaching on this chapter. And I don't understand this these couple of verses. And I got to preach this in like 5 hours. I don't know what to say. And I told him, skip it. Just gloss over it. Just kind of just blow past it and talk about the stuff that you do. I said, is there enough in the chapter that you do understand? Preach that rather than to just throw stuff out there and, well, you know, at least I covered it. No, make sure that what you say is right. And when I go back and listen to my sermons and I hear stuff that I don't agree with coming out of my own mouth, you know what it usually has to do with is, you know, historical stuff, political stuff, stuff that you hear, but you can't really be sure about and verify it. Because most of the doctrine, you know, I would say 99% of the doctrine has stayed the same since I started the church because of the fact that I studied it before opening my mouth. But sometimes I'll be listening to my old sermons and I'll hear something historical or political or social that I later learned more about. And it was like, wow, I shouldn't have been talking about that because I didn't know as much about it as I do now. And so we need to be careful that we don't talk about stuff that we don't understand and that we don't know. And I always tell this to young preachers, you know, preach what you know. You know, if you're coming to the preaching class and you're preaching that 10-minute sermon, pick subjects that you know the best and that you've really studied and read the Bible and you know, so that you're, look, aren't there certain things that we just know are true? And we have no doubt. We know that we're not going to have to, you know, 5 years later change our doctrine on it and say, you know, I was wrong about that. And by the way, if we are wrong about something, we should always be humble enough to change. You know, some preachers have preached the same thing for 10 years, and then when they realize they were wrong, they're like, well, you know, it's too late now. I've already been preaching this for 10 years. It's like, well, no, if it's wrong, correct it. You know, and I'll tell you one thing that I corrected real early on in my preaching was about Israel and about the Jews. Because I've been taught my whole life, you know, hey, we got to be pro-Israel. We got to support Israel. And when I started Faith Forward Baptist Church, even with all the study, even the scores of times I'd read through the Bible, I still had that in my head that had been drilled into me. And I remember I'd been pastoring for about 6 months. I don't remember exactly what the sermon was, but I was 6 months into pastoring. And I found myself saying something about, hey, that land belongs to them, or, you know, hey, they're God's chosen people. That started coming out of my mouth like 6 months into pastoring Faithful Word. And the moment, it was the first time I'd ever said anything like that from the pulpit, but it came out of my mouth. And the second it came out of my mouth, I thought to myself, you know what? I don't know if that's really true. I don't think that's really true. Because I was thinking to myself, I think I'm just repeating that because I've heard that so many times. I think it was maybe just the Holy Spirit telling me, like, you're wrong. And the moment it came out of my mouth, it had just come out of my mouth, and I was thinking, like, that's not even true. I don't think that's true. But I was like, I don't know. Maybe it is true. I don't know. And I literally went home and decided I'm going to read the whole Bible cover to cover just looking at this one subject. Because all these verses started flooding into my mind because I'd memorized a lot of Bible. And all these verses started flooding my mind about he's not a Jew, which is one, you know, and all these different scriptures started flooding into my mind. And I was like, you know, this is so different than what I've been taught. I waited 6 months before I ever preached against that doctrine because I spent 6 months making sure I was right first because I didn't want to just come out with something that was contrary to everything I'd heard my whole life and been taught until I'd studied it. And I spent the next 6 months, and the first thing I did was I read the entire Bible cover to cover, just looking for that subject only. Just reading the Bible where just that's all I'm looking for is anything to do with the chosen people, Israel, the Jews, you know, them in the Old Testament, them in the New Testament. And, you know, by the time I had gone through the whole Bible and I'd studied it and thought about it and figured it out, 6 months later in December of 2006, I preached the first sermon where I laid out that doctrine and taught it from the pulpit because I knew I was right. Okay. But you know what? There are too many preachers today just saying it's like I did. I mean, I did it. That, you know, I just had something come out of my mouth And it was just a verbatim quote from the church that I'd come out of. It was just word for word, repeating. And you know, we tend to repeat things that we hear. We cannot help but speak the things we've seen and heard. But we need to be careful to make sure that the things that come out of our mouth are right and that we don't say foolish things because of a lack of what? Knowledge, learning, instruction. And it's laziness that caused us not to study because much study is a weariness of the flesh. Right. Okay? And I'm not saying that we have to study all things and be an expert in all areas, but I am saying be an expert in the areas that you're going to talk about. You know, just learn about things and know what you're going to talk about. Or if you don't, at least say, you know, here's what I've heard. Or this is what I've always been told, you know, but do you have something that can correct that for me? Instead of just being dogmatic and just blowing up. And look, I've heard it my whole life and I've done it sometimes where you just vehemently repeat something that you heard. No basis in instruction, learning, facts, knowledge, or and so on and so forth. Let's get off that point, though. But people say a lot of stupid things, and it is a sin. It's not just dumb. It's a sin. The Bible commands us to increase learning, to be wise, to learn knowledge, and to not lift up ourselves and utter things that are too high for us that we know not. We need to make sure that we don't speak foolishness and that we intermeddle with wisdom rather than just wanting our heart to discover itself all the time, just to hear ourselves talk. And by the way, if you're going to be a pastor, you must be an expert on the Word of God. You don't have to be a science expert to be a pastor. You don't have to be a history expert to be a pastor. You do not have to be a language expert to be a pastor. You don't have to know Greek and Hebrew and Aramaic and Latin to be a pastor. But you know what? You do need to be an expert on the Bible. And obviously, when you start pastoring, you're not going to know as much as when you finish pastoring. Hopefully, you're going to keep studying and keep learning. But you say, well, what do I do when I start pastoring? You preach the things that you know for sure, and you save the stuff. If Bible prophecy is not your forte, you need to save it for later when it becomes your forte. But what's sad today is that pastors will get up and preach a pre-trib rapture, and then you walk up to them and say, hey, what about this scripture? What about? And they'll say, oh, well, you know, I haven't really studied the subject that well. Then you shouldn't be talking about it.
Right.
Now, look, I will admit to you right now, I do not know everything in the Bible. There are parts of the Bible that I don't understand that have me scratching my head to this day. Now, less and less as I get older, but there's a lot in the Bible that I don't know. And I've had people confront me. What about this verse? I don't know. So guess what? I just don't preach on those verses. And when I preach through the whole chapter, I just read that verse. And then I'm like, but here's what I really want to emphasize, verse 26. You know, and then, yeah, you know, talk about that. You know, and when I did the Revelation series, you know, I was like, you know what? There's stuff that I glossed over the first time I did it back in 2007. A lot of stuff I kind of blew past and didn't spend time on just because I didn't really understand it. So I really tried to dig in deeper and gloss over less and less and to actually preach on every verse and talk about every verse. I think that's what I did. So we need to just spend our lives studying and learning and not talk about things until we've had a chance to verify things. And whenever I hear a preacher say something, I like to go verify it first thing. And if somebody tells me some historical thing, hey, did you know that this and this? I want to go verify that before just telling it to everyone that I've ever known. What else? Now, this is the big one, and I'm going to spend the rest of my sermon on this. Here's the big one. I have a bunch that I'm not going to get to. But here's the big one that I think James is really dealing with. And this is the subject of tattling, tail-bearing, backbiting, railing. This is when you're basically talking bad about other people behind their back in general, okay? Or just saying hurtful things that are not to edify or help anyone, but they're just to tear other people down. This is one of the big ones, and I think this is what James 3, if we were to take the immediate context of what James 3 is really dealing with, I think this is a big part of what he's dealing with. But let's look at it in Proverbs, though. There are a lot of scriptures on this in Proverbs, but it says in Proverbs 26, turn to Proverbs 26. While you're turning there, let me read this from Leviticus 19, verse 16. Thou shalt not go up and down as a talebearer among thy people. Did you hear that? Going up and down as a talebearer among thy people. Neither shalt thou stand against the blood of thy neighbor. I am the Lord. What does it mean to go up and down as a talebearer? It means that basically you're the person who knows all the scandal, all the scuttlebutt, everything bad that's going on. And if anybody wants to get the juiciest tidbit, you know, you're the one that they're going to go to. And as soon as something happens, you're going to be on the phone. And because it's not a going up and down anymore, because we have technology. So you don't have to physically go up and down and go door to door. Hey, did you hear about, you know, now it's just so much easier to be a talebearer. And I think that there are more people guilty of this sin in 2015 than there have been in the past, because you've got the phone and then you've got the internet, you've got email, you've got Facebook, you've got the text messaging. And so you're able to go up and down in just a few seconds. And it's funny because in 1 Timothy chapter 5, you don't have to turn there, but it talks about women who don't have kids becoming idle, you know, not finding enough productive things to do with their time. And it says, with all they learn to be idle, wandering about from house to house. That's the going up and down. And not only idle, idle means they're not doing anything productive. Not only idle, but tattlers also, and busybodies, speaking things which they ought not. I will therefore that the younger women marry, bear children, guide the house, give none occasion to the adversary to speak reproachfully, for some are already turned aside after Satan. And so what the Bible is saying is that if a woman gets married, has kids, and takes care of her household, and the virtuous woman, the Bible says, does not eat the bread of idleness. She's busy. He says, if you will care for your family, that's going to keep you from getting involved in everybody else's business and becoming this tattler and busybody and talebearer. Now, I dare say this, though, that with the technology today, even women who do have kids and are taking care of their house can do this on the side because of the smartphone being right there, that they can literally be cooking the food and everything. And rah, 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 rah. You know, even if their hands are busy, they got the voice to text going. You know, and they can be nursing the baby or cooking the food or vacuuming the rug or doing whatever in their house and still get caught up in being a tattler, being a busybody, and even being idle. You know, the virtuous woman wasn't idle because she has to make her own clothes from scratch. Hard to be idle when you don't have a washing machine. Think about this. No washing machine, no dishwasher. You're the dishwasher, okay? No washing machine, no dishwasher, you know, and you're kindling a fire to cook food. You know, it's not just a little, you know, I mean, you have to, you know, you got to get the wood, you got to make the fire, you got to cook the food. You're scrubbing pots and pans, you're scrubbing clothes, you're making clothes. You don't just go to the thrift store, you know, on the dollar days, 50% off, and come out with a cart full of clothes for 20 bucks or something. I mean, back then, each garment is handmade. And, you know, women today think about making clothes from scratch, but they're starting with the fabric. That the hardest part is making the fabric. That's what the Bible talks about over and over again. The wool and flax that the virtuous woman seeks are making textiles from an animal-based textile would be the wool, and the plant-based textiles would be the flax, linen, okay? And so they're spinning the wool, and they're making clothing from scratch. And so that kept them busy. And God warns about women becoming idle and basically becoming a busybody. What is a busybody? The Bible talks about being a busybody in other men's matters. It's when you are worried about what everybody else is doing. Instead of just living your own life, you want to know every twist and turn of the latest drama and the latest scandal. And, you know, men can be guilty of this too, of course. But, you know, the Bible is specifically in this scripture directing it at women. Other scriptures direct it toward men. And it's something that, you know, a lot of people are guilty of. In 2015, look down at your Bible there in Proverbs 26. It says in verse 20, where no wood is, there the fire goeth out. So where there is no talebearer, the strife ceaseth. As coals are to burning coals and wood to fire, so is a contentious man to kindle strife. So there are contentious people who start the strife and start the drama. And then there are talebearers who just fan the flames of the drama. There are people who thrive on drama. When nothing's going on, they're bored, they're unhappy, and they just love it when the latest, you know, the latest news flash of the drama and the scandal, and did you hear what so-and-so said to so-and-so? Okay, now there are two kinds of people that the scripture is talking about in Proverbs 26 here, in 20 and 21. There's the talebearer, and then there's the contentious man. And of course, this would be contentious man or contentious woman, just as the talebearer could be man or woman. And so what it's saying is, first of all, there are contentious people. These are people who go around starting stuff with people. These are people who wear their feelings on their sleeve and are ready to be offended by every little thing that everyone says. And you know what the Bible says? Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. The Bible talks about passing over a transgression and not worrying about it. But there are people who are just contentious people, and they're always at strife with other people because of the fact that they are just feelings on their sleeve. Everything you say to them, it's like, what's that supposed to mean? What's that supposed to mean? You know, you could even say something nice to them and they'll interpret it wrongly. Like, you look wonderful today. So what are you saying I usually look like? What do you mean I look wonderful today? You know, they just interpret everything. Or just, wow, I tasted your chili at the chili cookout. I was just blown away. I was shocked by how good it was. I mean, it was amazing. Why would it surprise you that I know how to cook good food? What do you think, I cook garbage and you're surprised when it tastes right? I'm just saying there are people out there who are just contentious people who are just looking to be offended. They're just looking for somebody. And then, oh, it doesn't stop with what's actually said, but just the way that she looked at me. She gave me a dirty look. Or even a step further, and this is the worst, people. When you're getting mad about not what someone did, but what they didn't do. You're actually getting mad at people for what they did not do. Like, for example, you know, the pastor did not shake my hand. He did not smile at me. He did not greet me. She came to church and greeted a bunch of other people that were in the same part of the building as me. Didn't greet me. Invited everybody to so-and-so. Didn't invite me. You know, basically what you did, or you know, I put up this post on Facebook, and I saw that they were on Facebook liking other stuff. And in fact, they liked something that was that someone just before me posted. And then they liked something after, which proved that they were online when I was posting, and they just, or just, you know, I know so-and-so just has this thing where they'll just never like anything I do on Facebook. I don't care what I put up on Facebook. About 3 weeks ago, they just quit liking my posts and never click like for the last 3 weeks. What is her problem? What is his problem? You know, why, and clicking like on everybody's comment except mine. Look, it's getting kind of close to home now. And then, look, that is a contentious person. You know, that is an unforgiving, grudging, envious person. Because here's the thing. A healthy person who, you know, is humble and serving the Lord isn't so worried about what everybody else is doing all the time. They're worried about their own personal walk with God. And they're worried about making sure that they're doing what's right. They're not worried about making sure, being the police, that everybody in the church is doing everything right. No, they're just worried about, hey, am I acting right? They don't go to church and say, I wonder if anybody was rude to me. Who cares? You know what they should be thinking is, I wonder if I was rude to anyone when I went to church. That's all that should matter. Amen. Is that when we go to church, we make sure that we're nice to people. And that we love people, and that we're kind to people, and that we're not rude to people, and that our kids are not terrorizing the place, and that our kids are not treating other people bad, and that we are, and that our wives are not treating other people badly, and that we are under control instead of just always being out to find the fault in everybody else. So that we can pin them to the wall, and we're gonna nail them to the wall, you know, and I'm gonna confront them, and I'm gonna expose them. And I'm going to talk to other people and see if they have the same experience. You know, this is what a contentious person is. Then the talebearer thrives on this, of being sure to spread this, because it's, you know, turn it from a little local fire that the tongue has kindled, instead of just a local fire that the tongue has kindled of, you know, me telling Brother Garrett, you know, what's going on, then he's like, okay, let's burn this whole place down. And he's going to start getting on the phone, he's getting on Facebook, he's getting on email. I say that because Garrett is the last person that would ever do that. How long, Garrett went years without even owning a cell phone. But he has one now. How long did you go without a phone? You were in the wilderness, man. He was in the wilderness probably. He had no phone, no computer. It was great. But
no car.
Yeah, no car. Yeah. So Proverbs 26, let's keep reading because it goes on here. First of all, it said, you know, in verses 20 and 21, what we saw there. But look at verse 22. The words of a talebearer are as wounds, and they go down into the innermost part of the belly. What's the Bible say? You're hurting people when you do this. And a lot of times you hurt people, and it goes deep into their belly, and it does irreparable damage. You know, you can actually hurt people and hurt relationships. You can hurt marriages. You can hurt friendships. You can hurt churches. You can hurt pastors. And you do irreparable damage. That's why God's saying, behold how great a matter a little fire kindleth. You must tame the tongue and not let it get out of control. He says in verse 23, burning lips and a wicked heart are like a potsherd covered with silver dross. What's he saying? You might look good on the outside, but you're worthless on the inside if you're one of these burning lip, talebearer type of gossiping people. He's saying, you know, you're wicked on the inside. And he says in verse 24, he that hateth dissembleth with his lips and layeth up deceit within him. Go to chapter 25. While you're turning there, I'll turn at 25, verse 23. While you're turning there, I'll read for you from chapter 11, verse 13. A talebearer revealeth secrets, but he that is of a faithful spirit concealeth the matter. So you say, well, Pastor Anderson, what do I do if someone is a backbiter or a talebearer? Because sometimes it puts you in a weird position when someone comes to you and starts criticizing someone else or ripping on someone else or slamming somebody else or trying to get you involved in someone else's fight, okay? And it puts you in an awkward position because you don't want to just kind of smile and nod because you feel that silence is agreement when you do that. And you don't want that person to keep coming to you with stuff because a lot of times, if somebody comes to you and tells you the scuttlebutt and you just kind of ignore them, then they'll keep coming back with it because they feel like, oh, this is somebody who listens to me when I want to say this stuff. But this is the reaction we should have when people come to us. This is what the Bible teaches. Verse 23, the north wind drives away rain, so doth an angry countenance a backbiting tongue. So how do we drive away that backbiting tongue where they're not going to keep bringing us this stuff is with an angry countenance. Angry countenance. What's your countenance? Your face. So when somebody comes to you with this stuff, you need to give them a dirty look and have an angry countenance. And you need to make it clear to that person that you're not interested in listening to that. I don't want to hear that. You know, and not laugh and smile and you know, but rather, you know, what? You know, I don't want to hear about this. With the, you know, this is the face. You need to, let's all practice our angry face. I want to look around and see. Okay, let me see. Everybody, okay. That should be the gut reaction when somebody comes. Now look, I don't want to be misunderstood, and I have so much more in the sermon, but I got to close it down, but I don't want people to misunderstand this because a lot of people will get confused on this and they'll basically sweep things under the rug that need to be brought to someone's attention because they're like, I don't want to gossip. Now think about this. What's the difference between being a talebearer, a busybody, a tattler, and someone who is actually raising a legitimate concern that needs to be addressed? You know, where do you draw the line? I'll tell you where you draw the line. When you're doing it for entertainment, you're in wickedness there. If this is something that you're doing because you're bored and it's fun and it's entertaining you and you're enjoying it, if you're enjoying it, it's probably tail-bearing and backbiting. If you're having fun with it, if it's a pleasure for you to repeat the matter, then it's wrong. Okay, number two, I'm just giving you some things to do a self-check on your own heart and on your own situation. You know, if you're enjoying it, if it's fun for you, okay, number two, if you're telling it to someone who has no involvement in the situation, who has no authority involved, all you're doing is just being a tattler and a busybody and a gossip at that point. Now, there's a difference between that and actually going to a person that actually is in authority, that is responsible, and saying, hey, there's something going on that you need to address. The difference is actually wanting to fix the problem with a legitimate authority rather than just, you know what, I just want to make sure everybody knows what a blank she is, you know, or what a blank he is, or I just want everybody to know about it, or, you know, I'm just so happy to take them down a notch, or I just enjoy talking about this, or whatever. That's the difference right there. Now, let me give you some examples, okay? For example, you know, let's say someone is committing one of the sins that is on the list in 1 Corinthians 5 that the Bible calls leaven that we cannot have in our church, because obviously everybody in our church is a sinner. We all sin. Nobody's perfect, myself included. I commit sin, you commit sin. But there are certain sins that God does not allow us to tolerate in the church. And he says that we have to put away from among ourselves these wicked people. And those are the sins that are listed in 1 Corinthians 5 that are cancerous sins that will destroy our church. The most common one is fornication. And God, you know, so here's the thing. If you find out that someone in the church is living with their girlfriend or living with their boyfriend that they're not married to and living in sin, living in fornication, coming to the pastor and telling the pastor, listen, I think you need to know that so-and-so is living in open fornication, then, you know, that's something that I need to know about because I need to go deal with that person and discipline that person out of the church. Okay. Or, for example, drunkenness is another one. The Bible lists fornication, drunkenness, okay, being an extortioner, okay, being a railer, and all of these would take their own sermon in and of themselves, idolatry, covetousness. And so I've gone through sermons where I went and defined each one and explained what exactly God's talking about, kind of people should be thrown out for these various things. So if someone is a railer, making slanderous accusations about other people, going around as a talebearer, that is something that needs to be brought to the pastor's attention because that's on the list. If you see somebody out in Tempe drunk on Mill Avenue and they're drunk, you know, that's something that, you know, needs to be dealt with. Now, if somebody, you know, and again, where do you draw the line? You know, if somebody has one beer in their fridge, you don't have to come tell me about it. You know, it's sin, it's wrong. I'm against it, but that doesn't necessarily make them a drunkard. Okay, so what I'm saying is, you know, by the way, if somebody's smoking, you don't have to come tell me about that. And look, I'm against smoking. But, and listen, this is, let me just give it to you in levels. If you're going around to other people in the church, hey, did you know so-and-so smokes? That's wicked. You're a talebearer. You're a backbiter. Okay, that's the most wicked version. Then coming to me and telling me, well, you're an authority. Yeah, but I don't have authority over people's smoking. You know, God didn't say cast out that wicked smoker. You know what I mean? He said to cast out the drunkard and the fornicator. And look, I'm not condoning of smoking. I'm against smoking. It's destructive to your body. But you know what? You don't have to tell me if somebody's smoking any more than you have to tell me if they're pounding a bunch of junk food. You know, because, I mean, they're both destructive to the body, okay? So I'm saying, and look, if you see, you know, a woman is in pants, I got to go tell everybody that I saw so-and-so the woman out in pants, or I saw, you know, I'm going to go tell Pastor, I don't need to know that. You know what I mean? Nobody's perfect. People are different stages of growth in their Christian life. And, you know, you're just being a talebearer when you just pick apart people. And, you know, or, hey, you know, I caught somebody listening to so-and-so the music. And I'm going to go tell all my other friends at church. That's ungodly. That's wicked. You're being a talebearer at that point when you're repeating sins. But what if somebody's a child molester? Yeah, you bet. Don't sweep that under the rug. Don't hide that. Somebody's a sodomite or a child molester or someone's committing adultery. Someone's committing fornication. I mean, these are things that need to be, and even those, you don't just go spreading them around. You take it to the people that are in authority. You know, somebody's child, maybe somebody's child is in sin. And maybe even a lesser sin, but because it's a child, you go to their parent and tell them, hey, look, I just want you to know your child was seen doing X, Y, and Z so that they can discipline their child. See, as a pastor, I have the right to discipline those that are only committing that limited scope of fornication, drunkenness, and a few things. And the way that that discipline works is that that person's given a chance to repent or else to be expelled from the congregation. That's the discipline, is that they'd be thrown out. Now, parents have a much broader scope of discipline, don't they? Parents have a lot more authority over their children than a pastor has in the church. So the children, if they are committing sin and you tell their parents so that they can be disciplined, that makes sense. Okay, but when you're just going around, have you seen what a brat so-and-so's kids are? Did you see how they were acting? Oh, you've noticed it too? Yeah, because I was just talking to so-and-so and they think their kid's a brat too. And when you're talking about who you saw in pants and who you saw, you know, smoking and who you saw with a wine cooler in the fridge and who you saw, whatever. I mean, when you're just going around, you heard the bumping music, bumping out of their vehicle or whatever, and you know, and I mean, there are a lot. What are some other examples of just things that you could find, you could catch people and say, yeah, oh man, the TV in their house and the DVDs that I saw. You know, and you just go around telling people about what DVDs they had and you know, the fact they have a TV and that they, you know, that, you know what that is? That's hurtful, that's destructive, it's harmful. And look, this isn't a small sin, it's a big deal. And God says that your tongue is set on the fire of hell and that if you don't learn to control it, your religion is in vain. God says that you must bridle your tongue. It's an unruly evil. It's full of deadly poison. It's a world of iniquity. You're wounding people. It's going down to the inward parts of the belly. The whisperer separateth chief friends. You're hurting relationships. You're hurting people's marriages. You're destroying lives. And the Bible says death and life are in the power of the tongue. And the Bible says a lying tongue hateth those who are afflicted by it. And so when you're lying, and especially when you're a backbiter and a railer and you're a whisperer and you're a busybody and you're a tattler, because you have a heart in you that has bitter envying and strife in your heart. Bitter envying and strife in your heart. And that is what is causing you to use your tongue in a destructive way. And the Bible says that it is earthly, it is sensual, and it is devilish. And these are serious sins of the tongue that we need to control if we're going to be right with God, if we're going to serve God and be used by God. Bitter envying and strife. You know, we think that someone is better than us in a certain area. Let's take them down a notch. That's where a lot of this comes from. Sad to say it, but it is where a lot of it comes from. Let's close on Ephesians 4, final verse. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4, and while you're turning there, let me just review the points for you. The points were, number one, lying. Number two, talking about perverted, gross, sick things. Joking about sin, dirty jokes is what we're talking about with that. Filthy communication, perverseness of the lips. Number three, boasting and bragging about how wonderful you are. Number four is, man, this sermon's so out of order. All right, here we go. Number four, being stupid and just talking about dumb things that you don't understand and just spreading lies because you haven't done the research. Number five, tattling, talebearing, backbiting, whispering. I think that's the worst one that James 3 is actually dealing with, most specifically. The one that we didn't get to is flattery, flattering. And then another one is cursing your brothers and sisters in Christ, parents. And when I say cursing, I'm not saying using words on a certain unapproved list. When I say cursing, I'm saying where you actually curse someone, as in you wish ill upon them, as in telling them, hey, you know, go to hell or, you know, whatever, something along those lines. Swearing, which is where you basically make an oath. That's why, by the way, when you go to court, they let you do it on oath or affirmation. Because you know how they say, do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? You don't have to do that because it's against the Bible. The Bible says not to swear. Swear not at all. And so actually what you say when they say, do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, you say, I affirm that I will tell the truth. Because then you're just letting your yay be yay, but you don't have to swear or oath. That's why even in the Fourth Amendment it says warrants are issued upon oath or affirmation, because it's against the Bible to make an oath or to swear. But listen to this, Ephesians 4:29, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Now, what does the word corrupt mean? Corrupt means it's decaying. The Bible says a good tree does not produce corrupt fruit, but an evil tree produces corrupt fruit. So corrupt communication is communication that is evil or harmful, because the word evil in the Bible means harmful. It's that which decays, right? If we talked about something being corrupt, we're saying it is decayed. So that's the opposite of the latter part of the verse when he says, that which is good to the use of edifying. What's edifying? Building up. So what the Bible's saying is that the things that come out of our mouth should not harm people and tear them down and cause decay and rot, but that rather the things that come out of our mouth should build people up and lift people up. So that should be the final judge of what comes out of our mouth. Is this helping the person that I'm talking to? Is this helping them? And sometimes, and by the way, a lot of people interpret this as, hey, just don't say anything negative. That's not what it says. Because sometimes it's edifying to say something negative to someone. Constructive criticism. A reproof or a rebuke can be appropriate and can be helpful. But what's your goal when negative things come out of your mouth? Is it to edify your brother in Christ? Is it to build him up and help him and restore him? Or is it just to tear him down and harm him and to cause decay and rot? Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that may minister grace unto the hearers. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. God, I pray that every single person who's here today would take this sermon to heart, Lord. And I know it's very tempting for people that are in the sermon to think, wow, I'm so glad so-and-so is hearing this right now. They really need it. But Lord, I pray that every single person in this auditorium would apply this sermon to themselves. And anyone right now who's thinking, yeah, so-and-so needed this, I'm glad they're here. You know what? That person is probably the person I'm talking to the most, because they have that strife in their heart toward others. Lord, help us all to examine ourselves and to be careful with our tongues, that we always tell the truth, that we always speak knowledgeable, and that we say things that are helpful and not harmful. And Lord, help us not to be an active listener when people tell us the scuttlebutt. Lord, help us to give them a dirty look of an angry countenance. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, let's sing one song before we go.
Song number 169, song number 169. Song number 169.